Hi everyone, my name is Yue Xiao from Advanced Cooling Technologies in Lancaster, PA. The topic I'm talking about today is efficient plasma-assisted dry methane reforming and catalyst decoking. The presentation number is 285. First, I'll quickly go over the background of the project. Syngas, as a critical industrial mid-product to make a variety of chemicals, is conventionally produced by steam methane reforming, or SMR, which generally provide a high hydrogen to CO ratio syngas between 3 to 5. Such a high ratio makes it less preferred in processes such as ethanol or methanol productions. As an alternative, the dry methane reforming DMR or bioreforming DMR plus SMR is introduced to provide a CO-rich syngas with hydrogen to CO ratio between 1 to 3. In addition, these processes consume CO2, so they can be adopted as a carbon capture approach. However, the problems of the DMR or the bioreforming is first the higher temperature. In this thermodynamic equilibrium calculation, we see that the Gibbs free energy only starts to become negative at over 600 degrees C, and in the industry, typically the temperature range is 700 to 900 degrees C with a catalyst. The other thing is coking, which is the carbon formation from methane cracking. So the coke can deactivate the catalyst, clog the reformer to increase the pressure drop, and eventually stop the reforming process. And this is the severe coking we observed in our lab test setup. And in the industry, people usually dope steam to the DMR processes, but generating steam at higher temperature and higher pressure will drive up the production cost. So although it reduces coking, it's generally undesirable in an industrial DMR or bioreforming process. So what we do is we wanted to use the plasma-assisted dry methane reforming, or PADMR as we call it, to utilize the non-thermal plasma that would allow the reaction to be carried out at a lower temperature compared to the thermocatalytic DMR processes. In addition, the high energy electrons and the electron impact reactions in the plasma enable a unique reaction pathways that could intrinsically reduce the coke. In addition, with the plasma and the catalyst and the thermal energy, you're expecting a synergistic effect that can further increase the total conversion. And particularly in our case, we adopted the dielectric barrier discharge DBD plasma, where you see that with the DBD, the coking is generally reduced compared to the case without the DBD. And in this figure, the DBD results, which are represented by the black symbol, you can see that it typically has a very high total conversion, although the energy cost is on the higher end. So the reason we use DBD is that it is already implemented in the industry in applications such as ozone generations. And in our project, we aim to further reduce the energy cost of the DBD-based PADMR processes. With that objective, we adopted a cylindrical DBD reactor with a discharge gap LG between 0.5 to 5 millimeter for packed bed and catalyst loading. And in the reactor setup, we use GC and mass spec to monitor the methane reforming and the outlet gas composition. And although not shown in this setup figure, we do have additional heating and insulations. Using this setup, we then performed a series of improvements on the reactor with the aim to increase the total conversion without increasing the energy consumption. Some of them are relatively easy, such as reducing the discharge gap size LG to subsequently increase the electric field and promote the reactions. In addition, we adopted the burst mode, which is essentially adopting a duty cycle to the original AC power signal to allow an increase to peak power without changing the total energy consumption. And these are our own zero-D simulations that models this burst mode and the promotion of the methane conversion using such burst mode signals. In here, different colors represent signals with different duty cycles, but the energy consumption represented by the area of these signals remains the same. Therefore, a signal with lower duty cycles would allow a higher peak power, just as this red line shows, And as a result, we have observed a lower methane concentration for this red line, which is the low duty cycle cases, indicating a higher methane conversion. And same findings were also observed experimentally previously. Further, we also noticed that particularly when we use catalyst, a secondary surface discharge will form between the edge of the outer electrode and the inner electrode to ionizing the atomic spheric air outside the reactor, as shown in this schematic figure here, as well as our experimental setup, where you can clearly see the filament discharge starting from the edge of our outer electrodes. Such a secondary surface discharge would induce energy waste, and to eliminate such a waste, we ended up adding an electrode cap, which is made of polymer, just dielectric polymer, to seal the edge of the outer electrode to the outer air. And as a result of these multiple efforts, with the same specific energy input, where the SEI at 300 kilojoule per liter, without a catalyst and additional heating, we have able to increase the total conversion from the original case, which is lower than 30%, to over 50% with the measures such as reduced the gap size, the burst mode, and the addition of the electrode cap. And this bump in the total conversion is 89% higher than this lower comparison case. Next, we worked on the catalyst. In this work, we adopted a lanthanum, cerium, nickel perovskite catalyst on cerium dioxide support to further push the conversion. The perovskite is easy to synthesize and have shown an excellent performance to promote the methane conversion. And we use cerium oxide for its high lattice and surface oxygen ion mobility and good coke resistance. And the catalyst in the powder form was implemented on a quartz wool, and most of our tasks were performed with additional intermediate heating at around 550 degrees C, which can be provided in the form of waste heat. In addition, these tasks were performed with the consideration on industrial processes, which is to maximize the methane conversion to eliminate the sequential separation in the downstream process. Although CO2 separation technologies are rather mature on the industrial scale, separating of methane is a bit more challenging to achieve. And in these tests, we use 200 milligram of catalyst and 100 sccm of CO2 and CH4 mixtures with a ratio of 9:1. Again, the aim is to maximize the methane conversion. The power we adopted is 75 watts with 50% duty cycle, and the results are summarized here. We first see that the methane conversion using the plasma has increased from about 25% in the case without additional heating to 50% at 550 degrees C. And these two cases are both without the catalyst. And if we add the catalyst but turn off the plasma, the CH4 conversion can get nearly 60%. But if we add catalyst, the plasma, and heating, they're all adopted in the same time, the methane conversion can go up to 90%, which is nearly four times higher than this initial case as a comparison. And here you can see the extra conversion is contributed by the synergistic effects between the temperature, the catalyst, and the plasma. And due to such high methane conversions, only 1% of methane is measured in the outlet gas, which typically eliminates the separation. And some of our higher temperature tests have shown a close to 100% methane conversion. And for the gas composition aside of CO2, we have a 9% of hydrogen and 24% CO. It's definitely a CO-rich syngas that can be mixed with a CO-lean SMR syngas, or we can typically use the plasma-assisted bi-reforming DMR plus SMR to engineer the hydrogen to CO ratio. Overall, our tests, if compared with other DVD DMR tests, generally provide comparable total conversion. In this case, we do have over 40% conversion, but our energy cost is lower than these comparisons, benefit from the catalyst and improve the reactor design. Particularly, our high methane conversion is suitable for industrial process with the elimination with the methane separation. Aside from the lower cost, I'll briefly talk about the intrinsic coke resistance. Typically, coke comes from the methane cracking. Particularly at lower temperatures, you see the carbon in a whisker form that will form to cover the metal catalyst and significantly lower the methane reforming reactions. And in principle, coke removing techniques would include the reverse Baudouin reactions for CO2 and the steam gasification of carbon if steam is doped to the DMR reactions. And in our test, we have indeed observed a reactor to be coked up, reflected by the reduced methane conversion. Here you see it reduces from 90% to about 78%. However, benefit from the overall catalytic and synergistic effects, the methane conversion is still higher than the case without the catalyst. In addition, we also performed the preliminary CO2 plasma decoking test using an accelerated coking test with only the methane plasma to form an intense methane cracking reactions. We pretty much coked the dielectric rod and the surface with a layer of coke represented by the dark color here. And then we flew CO2 into the plasma reactor to perform CO2 plasma decoking, and a visible coke reduction is observed in both cases. We also intermittently measured the syngas production increase after the CO2 decoking treatment. This figure shows the normalized restored syngas production versus the time where you see in the coked up reactor, the syngas production lowers to only 40% to the before the coking case. And you see after 4 hours of CO2 plasma treatment, over 90% of the syngas production has been restored. And if the CO2 treatment time has increased to 7 hours, the syngas production will be restored to 97%. Although these tests are preliminary, but it indeed generally demonstrate that CO2 treatment can effectively restore the catalyst and the syngas production. So a quick summary of our current work. Using the improved reactor and nickel perovskite catalyst, we have achieved a low energy cost PADMR at lower temperatures with catalyst. And we're able to control methane at 1% at the outlet to avoid the methane separation in the industrial processes. Along another line, we tested CO2 plasma decoking to restore the syngas production. Currently, we're working on further tests, particularly for the catalyst development and performing methane reforming tests with impurities such as sulfides, which is often found in the natural gas source. At last, I would like to thank the Department of Energy SBIR program to provide the funding. Dr. Lei Hong is our program manager. Our collaborator is Professor Balchasidis from the Chemical Department at Lehigh. Thank you, and thank the audience for listening. Thanks.